This week in Nerf, we've got afterburners, flywheel cages, and some controversy. I'm Jangular, and every Saturday morning, this is your source for first-party, third-party, and community Nerf news. Getting right into it, that controversy was sparked by Worker this week as they launched released a photo of what looked to be a very close copy of the Blaster Tech Scar that Blaster Tech over in Australia has made and produced for quite a while now and is a very popular option among Springer users. Now, this image shows two different size scar barrels in a very similar design, along with even the markings of the brass sizes, which is not something that Worker has done in the past. So it's pretty safe to say that they didn't just take design cues, they took the design. And this sparked a lot of outrage and public speaking against Worker and what they've been doing. And Worker responded. They let everyone know that they had taken what everyone had said and they have decided to not release the product, so it will not be sold, will not be available. And they had really been looking only at the Chinese market, where things aren't going to be sold internationally, so they can copy designs and not so much worry about the international market, I suppose. It's an interesting post, an interesting read, which will be linked down below, of course, for your consideration and reading. So you can be up to date and informed with all these things, but it was just a very interesting week of discussion and things evolving from this. And it's kind of something that's been bubbling under the surface for a while now. And while I do, you know, I am glad that Worker is going to pull this product and not sell it, it's not the only product they have created that is a design made by someone else. So there's more to talk about here, but they have said that they are going to try and listen more to the international community and what they have to say and try to maybe reach out a bit more. So hopefully that is the case and hopefully it is what happens and they do have some better products in the future for worldwide, because they are a massive company in terms of third-party products. Now, this leads into a different kind of related discussion topic, where there's a lot of things that get copied in our hobby and a lot of things that are kind of iterative and design little tweaks and changes. And there's a lot of different places that sell things that are very similar, if not the same, to other companies. So it becomes this question of morality and where do we draw the line? What is okay and what isn't okay? Worker became massive in our hobby because they gave us things like the stock that was from the Lightning Storm that wasn't really easy to get from the Super Soaker series, and they made it super available, super easy to get your hands on one, along with other things, a lot of carbon copies of Hasbro products. And we haven't really had an issue with that up until they started copying smaller creators. So is it okay for us to buy into copies of large company products like Hasbro products? Is that where we draw the line, where if you're a large distributor, it's okay to have you be stolen from and we support that? But if you're a small creator, it's not? Is it only for products that aren't readily available, maybe discontinued and harder to find? Where is that line and what is it? Because there are a lot of posts popping up more and more lately about people stealing designs or mimicking or emulating designs and not giving credit or taking things. And it's just a very, very interesting topic that I think as we continue to grow as a community, we're gonna have to address. And I don't know which direction that conversation is going to go, honestly. It's something that I will be reading intently and listening intently for, because I think it's going to be a very big topic in our community, again, as we continue to grow, which we are doing currently. So definitely leave your comments and your thoughts and your opinions on this down below, because it is something that I want to have a discussion on. We need to have this discussion at some point, so why not start it now and have it carry over, because it's not something that we're going to figure out or decide upon in one discussion. This is going to be a long process, but this is kind of the main thing I wanted to talk about in today's episode, because it does start to tread into like legal gray areas and things like that, and things that as these companies in our community get bigger and bigger, at what point do we start to see legal issues pop up and people actually protecting their IPs and things like that, because we see things that are open source, non-commercial, being sold as commercial products by some people, and they don't really get punished outside of community backlash, which is a punishment in its own right, because our community is so small in terms of people buying things that they aren't going to have the sales to support themselves. So it's an interesting topic. Like I said, I think we'll leave it there for now. But like I said, definitely leave your thoughts down below, because this is something very, very interesting and very important to everyone that participates in our hobby. So let's go ahead and move on, and let's talk about something from Argus ModWorks. This is the Leviathan kit. This is something I've been keeping my eye on for a while. This is a kit that works both for the Raven and for the Swordfish Bullpup kit for the Strife that Argus ModWorks creates that we talked about quite a while back. It looks awesome. Argus ModWorks just does some of the just most fantastic aesthetic work. The kits look awesome. The front end looks awesome. It looks very sci-fi, very cool, very interesting. And I like it. I dig it. I think it's really cool. And it's available now. I've been waiting for that announcement to share this with all of you. It is around $50 US, depending on which version you're picking up. And what I do like is that while it does come with, I believe, a 43mm crush cage standard, they are going to release different crush cage sizes, or the files for them rather, open source for anybody to print, so you can have different cage sizes and you can swap them in and out at will. And I think that's just so cool. It adds a little bit of modularity and accessibility for different game types that I think is awesome. I have always enjoyed Argus ModWorks' work, and I think it is definitely cool to see them kind of build more of an ecosystem around that blaster and the kit and their aesthetic stuff, so things come in and out. And I'm curious to see what they do in the future. You know, I love that kind of stuff, and it just always interests me. So I'm excited about it. I look forward to seeing what they do as they continue to grow. So the Etsy link and the Facebook post will be down below for that. One other thing I want to talk about today is something we talked about last week, actually, and is available now, and that's the Serenity Cage. That is now available. The Silver Serenity Cage is available for $50 US, available from Open Flow Project directly, and Foam Blast and Out of Darts. All three of those are selling them now, and this is a cage that is going to be 42.5mm crush, just like the first version, but the machining tolerances are better. And if you who have had a Gen 1 blue version may have encountered some issues, some quality issues in terms of flashing, or in my case with the first Gen 1, the screw ports weren't drilled out properly. But this should fix all of those issues. It also has a slightly longer barrel, similar to the Eclipse cage. Whether or not that will improve accuracy or groupings compared to the first one, we'll have to wait and see. But regardless, it is available now. Links down below, of course. Also, real quick, worth noting, Out of Darts, since we're talking about people selling these, his new website has gone live. So if you're shopping from Out of Darts and you are a regular customer there, the Etsy store is still going to continue to exist. However, he's not going to be adding new products to it. Everything new will be going onto the website only, which I believe is just outofdarts.com. And everything will be available there, because it's just a better platform for him. He can more easily organize things and make a better shopping experience for everybody, which I appreciate. I dig the site. I just wanted to share that with you because it came to mind, and we were talking about places you could pick up that Serenity Cage. So that website will be down below, of course. Most of you probably already know that, but just in case you didn't, figured I'd let you know. Let's go ahead and move on to our mod of the week. And this week it comes to us from Nurm of Nobicon, and this is Lil B. This is an XBZ Retaliator that has a pump grip to pump up the blaster and fill the XBZ tank. This is an aesthetic blaster to me. This is why we're featuring this, because it has a lot going on in terms of the paint job. It's not a simple paint job. There's a lot of layering, a lot of weathering, a lot of detail, a lot of grunge and grit and things like that. And just little things that I appreciate, like the grip on this and some of like the effects on it almost kind of make me think of like some classic Fender guitars. Just the way things fade out into like a darker shade or deeper shade. So I think it's a very aesthetically, visually interesting blaster and paint job with a lot going on, a lot to kind of parse and pick out and appreciate. So that's the reason for sharing this one. The post will be down below for it, of course. So go check that out to learn more about it. I think he's going to be doing a video at some point on this, but definitely, like I said, it's got kind of like a gritty feel to it, which is definitely Nurm's kind of go-to aesthetic, but I think it was cool, thought it was worth sharing, so go check that one out. But that's gonna leave us with the video of the week. And this is not a single video, but a series of videos. This comes to us from Ed Scar, and this is the Get a Grip series. This is a series where he talks about Nerf grips and other similar, you know, blaster grips and why they don't work, in his opinion, for the human hand, and why they may cause issues in terms of trigger pull and discomfort and things like that, which I thought was very interesting. I think it's a 5-part series, I believe, which all of them are interesting in their own ways and address certain topics. The end result is adjusting a strife grip to make it more comfortable in the hand and give a better trigger pull, which was super interesting to me. This is something that hasn't really, at least I haven't seen, been talked about a ton or exhaustively compared to other topics or subjects in our community. So whether or not you completely agree with all of the statements made in these videos, it's a discussion that I think is interesting and I think is worth sharing. So that's something that you should definitely take a look at. The links will be, of course, right over here and down below, as always, as we get to the end of the video. But as always, I do have to say thank you so much to everyone for watching, whether you are just watching for the first time, whether you've been here every single Saturday morning at 7 a.m. Pacific. I appreciate you. Thank you so much. Thank you to the patrons. Thank you for the people that share and like and all those things. You just blow my mind every single week, and I love being able to make these videos for you. So if you're new to the channel and you enjoyed this video, feel free to hit that subscribe button for more in the future. And if you have thoughts on what should be on this show in terms of news, mods, videos, always leave those down below. I love hearing from you. And as always, thank you so much for watching. I'm Jangular, and I'll see you next time.